средства за новия семестър на магистърска семинара с магистърска програма Културна антропология. Организираме съвместно с Червената къща на тема интерактивни филтони. И това е една тази, която следния семинар, който организирам в Червената къща, тъй като тя не е битва за това, но това, което разбираме. Днес семинар ще бъде на английски. Това всъщност продукцията само на български. След това му обаче ми, ако някой има нужда от превод в някакъв момент, просто да даде знак, за да спрем, да преведем и да продължим. Темата на днешния семинар тръгна, ние на няколко пъти се опитахме да организираме семинар, който е около левите движения. Първата причина да го организираме тръгна от атентата срещу Шарли Ебдо. Тогава по различни причини не организирахме семинар. След това искахме да организираме общ семинар около лявото и някак много навреме се случиха изборите в Гърция. И това се оказа перфектният момент. Идеята за тази форма, под която днес организираме семинара и за гост лектора ни е на Чавдар Малинов, който всъщност си водещ на дискусията. Аз само да кажа, се казвам Демислава Петрова и отговарям за цялото организиране на семинара, но всъщност нашия водещ на днешната сбирка е Чавдар Малинов, който пък покани Спирос Маркетус от Солунският университет, който всъщност ще ни говори, както сте видели, за историята на лявото въобще в Гърция, за да зададем конкретната ситуация. От тук нататък ще оставя думата на Чавдар, за да представи Спирос. Общата форма на семинарата. Ще имаме лекция около 30-45 минути или по-дълго говорено от страна на Спирос Маркетус, която искаме да превърнем в дискусия. Тоест, след това или по време на лекцията ще видим как ще се получи най-добре и трябва всички да се включите и да говорим заедно. И следно, тъй нямам микрофон, трябва да говорим високо.
Само да попитам, всъщност, интересоваме се, че някак си поставя този въпрос, дали има проблем, ако говорим само на английски без никакъв превод, така в резюме.
Няма проблем.
Че, ако има проблем, все пак давайте знак, ще действаме в момента.
Oh yeah, thank you Vetslava for inviting me to this seminar and thank you Spiros Markepos for accepting our common invitation to participate in this seminar with the presentation on the left politics in Greece. It's my pleasure to present Spiros Markepos, who is teaching at the Aristotle University in Thessaloniki, and who has studied the history of the Greek left-wing Greek movement and the left-wing thought in Greece, in particular, along with plenty of other topics from the modern and contemporary political and cultural history, including, if I'm not wrong, the history of the opera. other interesting topics. So, giving you the floor, you can of course organize your lecture the way you imagine to be the best one, but maybe we can also start with a very short introduction before going directly to the present situation, with a short introduction in, let's say, the historical development of Greece since the, let's say, civil war and the period of the occupation and the civil war, because it seems to me that to a large extent the present, we cannot understand the present political landscape in Greece and political controversies and debates without this quite traumatic heritage of the 40s. So the floor is yours.
So thank you very much, Vinslava and Zavara, for the invitation. I'm very happy to talk to you this afternoon. I suppose that it's not easy to know the basic things on Greek history in the last 50 years, and I agree that what is happening in these last years in Greece has quite a lot to do with the rupture of the civil war. In the 40s we had a war with Italy and Germany, then we had an occupation of present-day Greece by the armies of Italy, Germany and Bulgaria. And after the end of the Axis occupation, we had a British occupation. And the objective of this British occupation was to keep away from power the leftists, the National Liberation Movement. And before the war ended, actually in December 44, we had a big conflict in Athens that pitted on one side the National Liberation Movement that at the time had the control of almost all Greece and had a very strong guerrilla army, and on the other side of the security battalions, which were the Nazi formations that were developed by the Quisling regime in Greece, together with the British Army. And in this battle, the left lost in January 45. Actually, even Winston Churchill came in Athens the Christmas of 44, and he gave to General Scobie, the leader of British forces, the order treat the place like an occupied place. And the erstwhile allies treat them as enemies. And this is what happened. And after that we had a period of white terrorism, in which the people who had collaborated with the Axis actually persecuted and killed many of the people who had resisted the Axis, and a very pressing policy on the part of the regime that led to the outbreak of a second civil war in Greece that finished only in 1949 with the defeat of the left, a huge defeat of the left, which came about only after the British, who were the previous occupying power, had been replaced by the Americans. Actually, Greece, the intervention in the Greek Civil War was the cause of the formulation of the Truman Doctrine. And the Marshall Plan, it was the constitutive act of the Cold War, let's say. After that, we had a very difficult period in Greece, in which we had a very authoritarian regime. It had a parliamentary facade, but if you make an analysis of the real power, the people who really mattered were first the American ambassador with a huge apparatus of counselors, of army, of everything. Second, the throne, the Greek king who had been reinstated by the British and had a very reactionary policy. Third, the army, the Greek army that had been reorganized by the Americans and worked for the Americans quite openly. And in the fourth place was the parliament. There was, a right wing in the parliament and the anti-communist center in the parliament, the squabble between them. And, but they did not really matter. But in the course of the 60s, we had a very interesting development. On the one hand, we had an economic up then, all Western Europe was living its glorious 30 years for construction after the war. Greek economy went up, lots of capital came in from America and Western Europe. Lots of Greeks went out as immigrants, millions actually, to America, Germany, Australia. And the structure of the country changed from an agricultural, mainly agricultural country, to a mainly industrial and services economy. And at the same time, the other, let's say, pillars of power self-destructed. First of all, the king quarreled with the army after the 1967 dictatorship. We had a strong social movement in the early 60s that proved dangerous for the regime. And in order to forestall any radical developments, the Americans helped to impose an extreme right dictatorship in 1968-67. It was the Colonel's Junta, as it was called, the army which was completely controlled by the Americans. But they fell foul with the king. So the king tried to make a movement against them, and he lost, and he was thrown out. So the first pillar of the regime was destroyed. And in 1974, just as the economic crisis, international economic crisis started to bite, and because of course the military junta had not really helped the economy, and in general arms are not good dealing with the economy. And so in 1974 we had, on the one hand, the fall of the junta after a military defeat on the hands of Turkey. The junta had tried to impose a sister junta in the island of Cyprus and to impose there a Greek nationalistic program. In Cyprus, in the island, there are 20% ethnic Turks, and practically they were living in an apartheid situation imposed by the Greeks. And they tried at that time, the junta, to they overturned the previous government. They tried to occupy the island, and this caused, as it was expected, known actually, caused a Turkish invasion that led to the division of the island. The north became Turkish, the south became Greek. Tens of thousands of Greeks had to leave their places as refugees. And the general self-destruction of the army in this instance led, on the one hand, to the fall of the dictatorship, and to the re-establishment of a parliamentary regime, and on the second hand led to an anti-American wave, because people saw that all this was behind all this was the hand of the Americans. Kissinger actually was instrumental in bringing the catastrophe in Cyprus. So we have, in the space of 7 years, just at the time when the extreme right having its triumph, we had the self-destruction of the three pillars of the regime. And so we had a new regime that was parliamentary, without king, and whose new plan was integration into Western Europe. And the policy of that regime was, let's become members of the European Union, which will give us democracy, stability, and prosperity. This was the justifying discourse. And in 1981, Greece became the 10th member of the European Union. And after that, we have a period of stability, political stability, of very unequal development, which was positive for for the bulk of the population, but created huge inequalities. Greece is one of the most unequal societies in Europe. And integration in the Western cadre that, however, did not solve all the problems that it was supposed to solve. At the time, I remember this time, it was said that we will finish with the problems of corruption, with the problems of inefficiency, with the problems of our bad national character, and we will become good and corrupted, efficient Europeans. What happened actually was that Greece, like all the other peripheral countries of the European Union, became satellites of the strong central European powers. Not only satellites, but also victims of constant financial exploitation. And instead of converging the economies, in the space of the last 10 years started having very, very different economic outcomes. Now we have no convergence with the European Union, especially in the 15 years that we have been in the Eurozone. On the opposite, we have a return of the Greek economy to its state of the 70s. And today, the actual Greek incomes are worse than what they were before the introduction of the euro, in real terms. And beyond this, we had lots of other problems. For example, of course, the corruption did not end, just it became much stronger and it was done in much more efficient networks that started not from Athens, but from Frankfurt, from Berlin, from Paris, where huge firms like Siemens bought Greek politicians by the lot. Practically, they were the payload of the all politicians of the two government parties, PASOK and New Democracy. They were in the pay of Siemens and of many other firms. And this, of course, made them very, very blackmailable. It was very easy for the German government to use persons like the ex-director of Siemens, Greek Christoforakos, who, by the way, was the son of a very close collaborator of Axis in Greece. Greece was the only country in Europe where the people who had collaborated with the Nazis not only were not punished, but actually formed the nucleus of the new regime. The same persons continued to rule us up to this year. And all the Greek rich, super rich, are people who made their money in the time of the occupation. In the Civil War, or their children, or their children. These are the real ruling class of Greece. So the integration of Greece in the so-called United Europe was marked by huge inequality and huge economic inefficiency. And on top of that, we had in the 2000, in the notice after 2000, we had two traps into which the Greek people very happily fell. Because at that time, Greeks believed that by becoming part of the Euro, they were now strong people, very modern people, very successful people, very admirable people. And there was, at the time, there was almost no discussion about what was happening. And the two traps were, of course, the trap of the euro and the trap of the debt. They were very connected. Actually, the debt was in a great part, in the greatest part, in the hugely greatest part, it was not something that helped the lives of the people on the street. It was debt that was contracted by governments without people knowing anything, just in order to keep the Greek drachma at the time stable into the European monetary mechanism. That was, let's say, the first step towards the euro. It was to participate in this ERM, as it was called, you had to have stability towards the mark, but in order to buy the stability, you had to loan quite a lot of money. That's how the greatest part of the debt was contracted. After 2000, we had a much worse situation because there was huge debt, not only public but also private, because in practically the German and the French banks had lots of capital to send to the peripheral European economies, and they had to they forced, in a way, this debt onto not only Greece, but all the peripheral economies of Europe. And this was helped by being inside the common money inside Europe. Because at the time, the bankers thought that the peripheral economies would be equally stable like the Central European economies. But this could not happen because exactly the success of the Central European economies was based on the sucking of economic vitality from the peripheral countries. The constant surpluses of Germany and Holland correspond to equal deficits of Greece and Spain and Italy and even France in some measure, smaller measure. So there was a vicious circle put in place that led to the overburden with debt of all peripheral economies and to the loss of all financial instruments that might stop the situation on the part of the peripheral economies. And at the outbreak of the crisis in 2007, all peripheral economies were very badly equipped to answer it. But this was not a matter of public discussion. Everything was hidden under the carpet. Only very few people in the extreme left, actually, were talking about these issues, but of course nobody listened. I am proud to have been one of them, talked much earlier than most commentators about these things. So, in 2010, we had a very rude awakening. The Greek people were informed that actually they owed more than 120% of the Greek GDP, gross domestic product, they owed. To whom? To practically to French and German banks. And so we should live much worse after that. Nobody paid attention to that at the time. It took a few years for people to understand that this was not one downturn that would end very quickly, but that it would be the new reality that for the last 5 years, Greece would live what Bulgaria has been living actually since the 90s, the last 20 years. And people reacted with a time lag to this. It took time for people to understand what was happening. And this was not by chance, it was because of the media, because in Greece we have so-called free media, but actually they are all being owned by ship owners, by very rich capitalists who make their money from the Greek state. Most of them have huge interests in what is happening in Canada. And they own all the TV channels, all the newspapers, all the radio stations. And they, all the time, they promoted the propaganda that had nothing to do with reality. People were accused that the bankruptcy was because of them, because they drank too much, they worked too little, which of course is just a racist lie. According to the OECD statistics, Greeks worked the most on world level after South Koreans, and certainly worked much more than the Germans and all other European countries. These are the statistics by an organization that has nothing to do with Greece. And, but on the other hand, they are being exploited in the last 5 years by the economic guilds called. And we have had 5 years of continuous fall of incomes, more than 40% for normal people. But on the other hand, huge riches went to the top 1%. This is what happens anyway with the austerity policies. And we had a full deregulation of labor relations, of the economy, of everything, and a huge sellout. The Greek state was one of the states that were very rich. There were big public enterprises, very successful actually, that most of them have already been sold for peanuts, and also very expensive pieces of land in the center of Athens, or whatever, they have been given to practically to the same capitals who bankrupted the banks. Because the mechanism in all this was that Greece was borrowing huge sums of money. This is the so-called European saving of Greece, borrowed huge sums of money in the last 5 years, not in order to give them to the Greek people or to invest. There is no investment, and the Greek people live much worse than they used to live, but in order to give them to the banks. The Greek banks, since the beginning of the crisis, took more than 220 billion euros. And beyond this is the more than 100 billion that have been given to the lenders. These are huge sums. Greece has 10 million population. It means that every person gave 22,000 euros just in order that the banks stayed to their previous owners. And this happened because of, this was the European policy, it was not decided in Greece. This. It is the general European policy. In theory, in capitalism, if you have an enterprise and it does not go well, of course you lose it. And perhaps you go to prison if you have done something irregular. But in the actually existing capitalism, this does not happen on world level. What happens is that the people who have real power, and they are mostly connected to the to the financial institutions. There is a whole branch of Marxist theory in the last 20 years that studies financialization. It is a term much more precise and interesting than the globalization part, which everybody is talking. But what we are living in the last 30 years is the time of financialized capitalism, in which we have a second level of economy, the financial level, which imposes its needs on the real economy. And this has a relationship to the rest of the society very similar to what is happening, was happening in feudalism. What we are watching today, not only in Greece, but all over the world, is a return to the time before the French Revolution. Not only in the sense that things that had been abolished by the French Revolution return back, like torture, for example, which has become legitimate everywhere, thanks to the Americans, but also the fact that, like the nobles of the time before the French Revolution, today the bankers have no fear of losing their social position, because they get the profits, but when they do something wrong, it is the societies who pay so that they can still have their banks. Actually, all banks in Europe today are bankrupt. But all states in Europe have borrowed huge sums from the same banks so that to keep them afloat. Of course, all of this is a huge scam that at some point will be wrapped, will be punctured. We don't know when, but all people who are into the financial trade know that this cannot go on forever. The euro is actually a huge scam in which the European Central Bank creates out of nothing money. Now, it has decided to create $1 trillion and something more at the rate of $60 billion per month. This is being created out of nothing. The bank lends this money to the bankers at a very low interest rate, from 0.5 to 1%, and then the bankers lend this money to the states and to the households, the enterprises, at credit card interest rates, 10, 15, 20%. And in this way, in the last 15 years, the banks have amassed huge wealth, nominal wealth. It has nothing to do with real wealth. But they have a much more, now they are much stronger than they were before the crisis, which had been caused by them, but instead of paying for it, they made the states pay for them, and now they destroy the states. When Greece needed some billions, the European Central Bank refused to intervene, to give money to Greece. But now that the banks need the money, has no problem to give more non-trillion. And this is the third time that it makes this quantitative easing. They don't call it printing money, they call it quantitative easing. There were two previous ones at more than 1 trillion each. To understand what are these, what these things mean, let's just remember that a few years ago we had the conference on climate in Copenhagen, in which the scientists and the political representatives had arrived to a consensus that in order to stop the global warming, there would be needed funds of the class of 800 billion. And of course nothing happened because these 800 billion did not exist. Since then, the European Central Bank has created out of thin air more than 3 trillion just in order to save the European banks. And the American Fed has done the same, also more than $3 trillion.
Excuse me, could you, because they told you that we have to leave at something like 7 o'clock, and we need also
time for discussion.
Could you concentrate a little bit more on the political and social actors who oppose this policy?
Yes, I finished with this. Yes, it was difficult for the people to understand these things. People just in general don't know about them. I'm not sure that everybody here knows, for example, that Bulgaria, that is one of the least indebted countries in Europe, now plans to borrow 8 billion. It means about 1,000 for each one of you. It means that it will be 4,000 for a family of four. It will be 4,000. I'm not sure that many families know about that. This detail. And you will be asked to pay for this. And it is money that will not go to you, will not go to infrastructure, will not go to anything. It will go to save corrupt banks in Bulgaria. That's how debt is created. It took some time in Greece for the people to understand this. And it created lots of movements. With not a clear political sign. Many of them were in the left, many of them were in the right. But it was, I think, a strategic success of the left that quite early we had an alternative narrative of the crisis. Because the official narrative of the crisis was we all parted together, so now you must pay. Was said by one of the most despicable Greek politicians, Pagos, grandson of the dictator who had invaded Bulgaria in 26, if you remember. You know here about the Petrides Vasilis. You know, his grandson was a Pasok politician. And so, we had in the left, even though we were not acceptable to the mass media, we managed through the internet and through marginal media to give to the people these basic ideas that we are not responsible for. And the slogan of the Square Movement in 2011 was, we don't talk, we don't sell, we don't pay. It was a huge success. And it was a very lively time for all types of social movements from 2010, when things started happening, to 2012. They managed to bring down four governments. We had the non-elected authoritarian government led by a banker, Trapezeri Papadimos, who was instrumental in all the scams of the previous years, but it was imposed by the European Union, and also in this occasion we had the first entry into the central political scene of the extreme right party, Laos, also in the orders of the European Union. And but even this it fell, and in 2012 we had the first elections that also marked the end of the popular mobilization and the turn towards an electoral strategy. People in the elections brought seats up from 4% to 28%, and also created the hope of political change. And this continued until a month ago, Syriza got first, and because it attracted the votes of people from all strata. It does not mean that all people who voted for Syriza were on the left and had contact with the basic left ideas and values. But they gave to Syriza their dreams, their hopes, And of course, Syriza had more than 80% support at the time of confrontation with the European authorities. Since then, it fell because its leadership decided, instead of following the left policy of a minority in Syria, a strong minority, about 40%, and also of people in the left of Syria, like Andalusia. I'm an Andalusian, not in Syria, anyway, so I don't want you to think that the things that I say are Syria position, but there are many people in Syria who have very similar analysis to this one. We have a fall of support, a very precipitous fall of support for the government in Greece in these days, and it's not at all sure whether we will have a capitulation of the European Union as the leadership now wants to do, or we will have something very radical that will obviously lead Greece outside of Europe very soon, and will also delete the debt. The position of the left of Syriza and of the people who are on the left of Syriza is that we must delete the debt. We don't owe anything to the enemies of the humanity who pretend to have the right on our property. So I'm finishing here, and I hope we have the discussion. Just in order to give a very fine, but not very silly description of what is going on, and just propose to see this 2 minutes Dutch film. I suppose that you, many of you, have seen it already, but it gives in a very fine way.
Je hoort mij zo doen, hoe ik spitte meteen. Als de minister van geld, een politiek fenomeen. Dat ik dus kunt onderbinden, maar dat zie je direct aan. De fondsen verkopen aan een zuinige weg. Ik ben de juiste man, op de juiste plek. Laat de Grieken maar komen, want ik maak ze gek. Ik pak de centen terug, omdat dat betaald is. En jij gaat mij niet stoppen, Janus Faro Paakis.
Wat ik wel of niet doe, val ik zelf nog steeds. Schud mijn handen normaal, man, ik heb toch geen reeds.
Wat zit je nou te
horen met je gierige troon? Dit is ons eigen land, geen Europese kolonie. Je vindt jezelf deskundig, waar heb jij gestudeerd? Wageningen, god, gefeliciteerd. Ik heb een Cambridge, economie gedoseerd. Maar hé, hey, jij mag het zeggen. Wat doen we verkeerd?
Jullie economie ligt aan dergen en flarden. We steunen die chaison met onze miljarden. Nu moeten we zeker naar die lening gaan zwaaien. Je bent ons gewoon op zijn Grieks aan het naaien.
Je wilt je geld terug, dat zal moeilijk lukken. Van een kale kip is het onmogelijk lukken.
Oké, Janis, je hebt het zelf gewild. Angela, kill!
En toen de ERKEL aufmachen bitte een beetje snel. Jeroen gaf zij de hand klappen van. No disrespect, maar ik heb grotere ballen. Also, waarom fakt is, nou is het klaar. Jullie betalen dat geld terug en geen reabar. Anders raak je hal, als Europa lozen. Dan loop je lampen en woon je in dozen.
En we rijden op ezels en dan eten we steen. Die goedkope dreigementen, dat kun je niet nemen. Ik doe de deur open, je ramt er je voeten. Prima joh, chill, ga toch lekker naar Poetin. Pop Poetin in de haals, de schrik van het westen. Zitten jullie weer eens kleine Grieken te questen. Ga gewoon onze woorden met jezelf in de nesten. Ja, ze maakt de mijne, mag je Poetin gaan testen. Kom maar hier, Janis, want ik lust ze rauw. Je fikt met Athene, je vult in Moskou. Je pakt waar uw vaak is, Poetin pakt jou. Dan weet je zeker niet precies meer wat je zegt aan maal. Ofwel,
halt dein maal, Griekenland is van ons.
Wat zij zegt, maar dan met een diepere frons. Maak het duidelijk voor uw vaak, dus geef het 50 de bons.
Laat me even denken. Ik kom zo met de respons.
This is very well showing the mafia politics that are called the European Union politics, actually. It's very realistic what is happening.
So is Putin the savior?
Yeah?
Is Putin the savior
I don't think so. I don't believe it. But it just shows what is the level of discussion, what is the level of fraud in the European Union itself. This man Dijsselbloem, I suppose you have heard that he pretended to have a degree that he did not actually have. This everybody knows about it, of course, Netherlands. He said that he had a master's at the University of Cork, but the university said that no, there's no such. He was never good, but he was very known in the parts of the area. And he's the president of the Eurogroup. Not to talk about Soble, who had been condemned for high-level political corruption in Germany. Because practically he had the black. All the black money that was going to the Christian Democrat Party by the companies to call. He's also a very disreputable character. And these people are telling us that we have to die in order to get their money back, the inexistent money.
So the discussion is open, Professor Dikshev.
Thank you. I'm very much interested to know how you see possible left-wing policy in this situation. Usually the discourse you hold about debt is the discourse we have here from the right. Right-wing people tell us you shouldn't contract any debts, debt is bad, no debt at all, whereas the left, not only in Bulgaria but also in France and other places, the left is more easy with taking debts because you need to pay for social services and so on. So one thing I hear from you is no debt. Second thing, getting out of the European Union, so isolation. Do you feel that Greece can live alone? What else? I mean, how do you feel, how do you see the possible future?
Yes, I'm happy because you touch upon the two basic political issues in Greece. And actually now we have, these are the crimes, and on the position of that will be decided which way Greece goes. Debt and euro. And it is true that in what is called left, there are many people who think that the Keynesians actually. So it's not exactly left. It's the left in a capitalist framework. They say that, we will restart the economy by contracting more debt. As Tomáš Kétisa, who is an organic intellectual of the French Socialist Party, he's not a huge leftist, but in his book, The Capital in the 21st Century, I suppose many of you have read it, he explains how the state has two ways to get money. One is to tax wealth, and the other is to borrow wealth from the rich that does not tax. You can either tax the rich or get the money as loans from the rich. So it is not really left policy to get loans. It is if you don't want to tax the rich. You can tax the rich. And this is not a left policy. In the United States at the time of the New Deal, Roosevelt imposed more than 96% tax on the rich. 96%. In Sweden in the 70s, there were more than 98% tax for the rich. And they thrived, the societies. People believe that they can square the circle, be good both with capital and with the working people, by saying, okay, today we borrow and somebody else will have to clear the mess 10, 20, 30 years later. This cannot work anymore in this global, in this global conditions that we have now. This is the one thing. And the second thing is the euro. by becoming part of the Eurozone, Greece actually has destroyed its economic independence. And this was not by mistake, it was by design. Euro was designed exactly so that it takes from the countries the tools to have an independent financial policy and a democratically controlled financial policy. The European Central Bank is the most non-transparent institution on earth, and it is not accountable. There are bankers there in Frankfurt working only for the interest of the bankers, not of the people. When we were saying this at the time of the Greece entry into Europe, we were being laughed at. But now we see very clearly what this means. And Europe from the beginning was built on that purpose. Robert Mandel, perhaps you know him, he got the so-called Nobel Prize for Economics, an extreme right-wing guru of financial theory. He got the so-called Nobel, because it's not Nobel actually, for his theory of optimal currency unions. And according to his own theory, the Europe was not an optimal currency union, because it had very different economies.
I understand your critical passage, but two options I see here. One is world revolution in a way, or European revolution, socialist or whatever, or socialism in one isolated state. So this dilemma, how do you solve it?
Not really. Greece is an open economy and it will stay at any rate an open economy. But this does not mean that you have to be open to capital movement, for example. You can have very well the tourists for Europe, you can very well sell your olive oil to everybody, but you don't have to allow to capitals to come in and out of the country. It's completely different. When we talk about, of course, imposing capital controls, and about getting out
Europe,
of the
within Europe, within the European Union. Not possible.
Of course, it's possible, it already happens in Cyprus. This is the official European Union position. As also the official European Union position, which is something of concern to Bulgarians as well, even if few Bulgarians know it at the moment, is that in case of a bank failure, you will have bail-ins, like what happened in Cyprus, which means that depositors are treated as investors, that you lose your money if you have not put it in the correct bank. How can you know if it is the correct bank? God must protect. This is the official European Union policy. And we believe that we can go alone, without it. We don't need it.
Question from Mrs. Lavalier.
Thank you very much for the very interesting lecture. I learned a lot. I have a lot of questions, but let me ask just one. You said that the previous political establishment complied with the Troika treatment because it was embedded in a corrupted network. Well, then why did the Syriza political leadership
complied
so easily? They couldn't have been already corrupt, could they?
Because Greece, because there is this problem that the current Syriza leadership is also for squaring the circle, which means it is for stopping the memorandum policies of austerity and at the same time staying inside Europe. They were really unprepared for their treatment in the Eurogroup meetings. They really thought, they were very surprised to see that the Europeans did not back down. But of course, it was obvious that the Europeans would not back down, because from the beginning they had excluded the only credible threat, which would be get out of the euro. So what is happening is that on the 20th, actually tomorrow on the 28th, on the 28th stops the, let's say, the guarantee of the Greek banks, the financing of the Greek banks on the part of the European Central Bank with, through the normal mechanism, and practically they had to choose the Syriza leadership between saying here and now we leave the euro or trying to have a pretense of normality, which however is not normality. And they were afraid, and this created huge uproar in Greece and especially among the left. And quite a lot of people who saw what was happening, who were for euro until last week, now are against euro publicly, the position. There was never feasible the third road that Tsipras hoped for. You could either have, they created a huge intellectual construction that it is one thing the loans that we get from the European Union and another thing the austerity, and we can have the loans without having austerity. And many people inside Syriza and outside Syriza were saying that this is not possible. And in the last weeks it was proved that this is indeed not possible. So you have to choose either austerity and euro or end of austerity and outside euro, which will have a period of dislocation for some months, a difficult period, but it opens the way for a new boom in the economy. When we were saying these things 5 years ago, they were telling us, if we go out of the euro, you know, we will have 30% fall in the economy. And now we have already had 30% fall in the economy and no perspective for growth at all. But the same people who were saying these things at the time, today they have similar views. You cannot change course inside the euro because you don't have the basic instruments for having your financial policy. But and now, last week, only the Syriza leadership understood this simple thing. Now they have to choose this way or that way.
Valentina?
Yes, in a way my question goes into the same direction. Well, I've been trying to follow Syriza for quite some years now. I'm not sure that I'm getting the picture, so that's why I'm asking you a rather naive question. But I'm concerned about the program, about the political program. I get the discourse against Europe, against technocrats. I'm not that good into financial politics. I don't know how leaving the Eurozone will help Greece. I don't know about this, really. I can get this discourse that we must be independent and we don't need to pay the debt. Okay, I agree with this, but what would be the real left-wing politics of Syriza in the future? I mean, against technocrats, that doesn't make them leftists. And if you wish, I'm also asking myself a question. Can we go back to the welfare state? Is it what the left wishes today? What's the program of a left-wing party?
Actually, the euro was the instrument for destroying the European welfare state. And this was from its inception. And this had been stated, publicly stated, by Robert Mandel, who was the father of the euro.
So we will destroy euro
it is,
and we will go
the idea, the idea is that you take from the governments the instruments for financial policy. So at the time that the crisis comes, the governments have only one instrument in their hands. And this instrument is destroy the welfare state and lower the salaries and pensions and all this. And this that had been declared by Mandel as the rationale for creating the euro, he did not call it euro, he called it Europa, this was what actually happened. It was in the DNA of the Euro project, the crisis. It was not, and the objective was exactly to smash the welfare states, which from the point of view of the bankers, and the capitalists, are the enemy of economic development. What they see as economic development, of course, is the continuous accumulation of capital.
So this is the problem. We're going 30 years back. We're going back to the welfare state.
I don't believe that for the left the welfare state would be a worthy objective. The welfare state was creation of the liberals, and it is a way to soften the cruelty of capitalism. I don't believe that today we can have a left that will not be an anti-capitalist left. I believe you know Immanuel Wallerstein. He used to be the president of the World Sociological Association for quite a long time. And he has a very impressive theory of historical sociology. And he explained very cogently that we are now living the terminal crisis of capitalism. It is a system that was created 500 years ago. And now, after the 1970s, is in its terminal crisis. It will take, of course, a few decades to unfold, but at the end of it, we will have something that we cannot predict, but will be either a system that will combine the most authoritarian and exploitative elements of capitalism with the worst elements of others, or something that will be much more democratic and egalitarian and free than life and capitalism. And what will happen of the two depends on our own action and on our own conceptions. So I don't believe that we can have today progressive politics that are not anti-capitalist politics.
It's anti-capitalist, I don't believe so.
Not all of it, but quite strong part of it is anti-capitalist. But now also the conscience changes according to realities. Not many people who thought, believed that they could square the circle, who believed that you can change course without conflict, many people in Syria now see that this is not possible. And some of them, of course, will be afraid, but also many of them now, I see people who, until last week, were saying, okay, you're just leftist ideologues, now they see that Euro is something very hard and very, very pernicious.
And now everybody is focused on the ideas of Varoufakis. Exactly.
Varoufakis is a man of the right, he's not a man of the left, he's not even a Syriza member, he's a left Keynesian, and he had this very, very clever plan, a very rational plan on how to make the euro viable, but what he could not see was that this was going against the interests of the people who control euro and profit from the euro. And so politically it was a non-starter. It's if a historian knows very well that there are no historical examples of a ruling class that, let's say, left the present-day advantages just in order to create a more rational system. There's no such thing in history. So Varoufakis went together with Tsipras to tell to the Germans, to Schäuble and to Merkel, how they have thought of a splendid way to square the interests of Germany with the interests of the European Fair. And of course, the Germans told him, stop the bullshit. We know our interests. You don't know your interests. It was all these win-win situations that people imagine. There are not going to be win-win situations. It is us or them. And I say it is the enemies of humanity against humanity.
Just add a question to this currency thing. I don't quite agree with your ideas about jumping over capitalism into something we don't know, but that's another question. I read a text by Varoufakis from 2013, I think, where he imagined the introduction of a parallel currency, like the Bitcoin. He called it Fedcoin or something like that. Is that seriously sure or not?
Yes, this is an attempt to evade the basic construction of the euro, which is that you don't have liquidity. Yeah. But if you do that, you negate the purpose of the euro. So it's obvious that they will not allow to do that. As for what capitalism is, I don't know, of course, we don't know yet what can come after capitalism. But what we know for sure is that today capitalism is Fukushima capitalism. You don't, people say here, oh, Greeks are lazy and thieves, Bulgarians are, I don't know what the national stereotype, but there is a good capitalism, a real capitalism, which is Canada, which is America, which is Japan. And you see what happened in Japan, in a model state, a rich state, a well-ordered state, a strong state, let's say one of the beacons of capitalism, mm-hmm. one of the first states. They just, a private company, Petco, put not only one, many nuclear stations, just at the places of what it was predicted that it was very dangerous. And they took no security measures. And when the tsunami came and everybody was contaminated, again there is a huge leak these days, nobody felt for that. The president of the TEPCO and all the others have not even been sent to court. And they continue to get trillions of yens in loans by the same banks who ask the money, the non-existing money from the Greeks. I repeat, they are enemies of humanity. And now it is of critical importance for humanity to destroy capitalism. If we do not destroy it, it will destroy us. Actually, the leukemia, I know because my ex-wife is a hematologist, the leukemia percentages have gone through the roof in the western coast of American Canada. And it is directly related to the Fukushima incident. Do you read about that? No. Somebody should apologize for what has happened. Nobody has apologized. Capitalism is Fukushima.
Maybe closing with another direction of what you just said about apologizing. I'm wondering, is there a need to rephrase some terms such as solidarity or responsibility? Because, for example, when you talked about this politician who said we are owing this boat, you can see how certain ideas about community or solidarity are being used by, let's say, capitalist or right-wing politicians, while left politics struggles to, let's say, to argue for independence or removal from shared responsibility in this respect. So, like, how is this need to, let's say, to shift the meaning of those terms in a financial world? Does this somehow reflect on, let's say, social processes or other kinds of debates which happen in the country itself?
Yes, I agree that there are quite a lot of discussion, battles going on, and will continue to go. That's why we also must find a critical language on these things. Because a basic instrument on the part of the bankers and the capitalists has been to create the impression to the people that if you don't have a PhD in finance, you cannot understand what is happening. Well, actually what is happening is very simple. It is a huge level of exploitation, huge. And you don't really need a PhD for this. There are actually, if you read David Harvey, for example, he has a very good analysis, very understandable, my students understand it very well, about what is being done today. But it's not only a financial matter. And also for me, It's very important to demystify the words. People talk about the markets. The markets are powerful. The markets must trump democracy. The markets know better. The markets might be afraid, so we should give our blood so that the markets, whatever the markets. The markets are the religion. This is the markets. Who knows? What is debt? There is, I suppose you know about the David Graeber book, Debt, the First 5,000 Years. It is a master, they don't agree with anything with him, but you must see how debt has become something that stops thinking. You owe, so you are, first of all, sinner, and second of all, you have the obligation to give. Debt is slavery, actually. And this is the original meaning of the word, was sin. Mesopotamian times. Debt means that there is no freedom. But why? Actually, if you see the debt, or if you add up the debt, it is seen that it is much more than the work product. How can we owe all this money? And to whom? To the Martians? All this is just logistical games. But people just they have not been taught to think about this. Like when you see that there is discussion now on getting 8 billion more, that nobody says to people that this is 4,000 for your family, which of course will not be paid as 4,000, it would be a multiple of that. That you become slave for this, for money that is not being given to you. It is given so that some corrupt banker is being saved. When the Irish banking crisis started, there was a... It became public, the video of the top banker in Ireland discussing with the other criminals how would they persuade the Irish government to give them the money to save them. And he's discussing with the others. And he says we must ask for 7 billion. Of course they knew that it would be more than 100 billion, but it would be the bait, 7 billion. Of course, they knew that nobody in government knew anything about all these details. And the others, somebody asks him, okay, but how do you arrive at this 7 billion figure? And he says, I took it out from my ass, literally. That's how I took it out. That's how they believe, that's how they behave, and that's how they destroy the lives of entire societies. This is capitalism. This is the Fukushima capitalism. And financialized state of capitalism. Because of this, in order to save this man, the Irish economy has the worst catastrophe since the potato famine. Just a few persons, but they are very well placed, and they know very well what they are doing, and they have all these levels of support. But they are not enough. In Greece nowadays, we have the one of the, perhaps the first, real left-wing revolt against this. But we must also know something, that if it is not the left that destroys the euro, it will be the right. Because in 2017, they will have the elections in France, and as things go, the presidency will go to Marine Le Pen, who has a very cogent anti-euro narrative, and she's going, everybody's afraid that she's going to take France out of the euro because she's not for the interests of the people, for the interests of the French capitalists. Whom
and then we will have the dollar afterwards. It will be only the dollar afterwards. After the euro is destroyed, what comes
out? Every country will have the national...
All the national currency, the dollar.
Mm-hmm. No, it's not like this. The dollar is also in a very difficult situation. Mm-hmm. We are living, this is the crash of capital. Actually, there is a huge bubble. All these 30 years of the financialization, of the liberalization of financial capital, created a huge, there was nobody to control. If I paint, I photocopy a 5 euro note and I give it to get a pack of cigarettes, I will go to jail. If I'm a banker, I can create 30 billions just like that, with no control, no questions, and I can do whatever I want.
Let me just contradict you. You want to step out of the euro, which is a legitimate option, of course. Then the drachma will become a very weak currency. It will fall very much. I remember what was the franc and what was the Italian diretta in the 70s. It was very weak currency. The euro was created in order to have a sort of stability of currency.
No.
Is it good or not? That's another question. I share some of your comments. But the drachma will be a very weak currency. So you'll have German investors coming and buying for, as you say, for peanuts, your land and your hotel and so on. So why do you think this is better?
Yes, this is...
It will become, everything will become very cheap in Greece.
Something that we hear from many people in Greece. The answer is, the euro was created first in order to have the seigniorage rights to become a world currency. World currency is a Marxist term that had been resurrected by the theorists of financialization. Kostas Lavrovitsas, a very good Greek economist, perhaps you have heard of him, he's a member of the Syriza left, he's a very good friend of mine also. And he has explained very well what it means. It gives economic advantages to have a world money. And this was the plan, not only of German, but in general of the European capitalists. But the main objective of Europe, beyond that, was exactly to smash the welfare state. This was the objective. It is not hidden. For the people who want to see all the rationale for the introduction of the euro, it is there, it is written. You can, I mean, if you should, for example, check the palace, Greek palace, Starbucks, who is a pupil of Friedman, actually, and he explains, he also has this discussion with Mandel.
We don't have the euro anymore here, they destroyed the social state in the 90s.
Yes.
But we are already free. In the Eurozone without voting rights.
No,
because
in the
90s we respect to the euro, we are technically in the
euro. Now, you are in the states that Greece was before 2000. You are obliged to take huge loans so that you keep your parity with the euro, without even having voting rights. Not that this really matters, as the Greek case proved. It's not people think that Europe is a European Union is a construction of equals, of partners. It is nothing of the sort. It is a hugely hierarchical construction. There are the real equals, which are the Germans, the almost equals, which are the Dutch, the Finns and all this, and the others, and all this is the mechanism for huge economic exploitation and political exploitation also. Because the politics in Italy, in France, in Spain, in Greece are being defined by Germany through mafia methods. This is the simple reality of the European Union in 2015.
Yeah, thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. I'm sharing this criticism, absolutely. But the politics is always about real things. So I'm curious about your prediction. What will be the next steps of Syriza, having in mind this huge pressure coming from outside and this big pressure coming from inside? So what to expect in the next weeks or months?
Historians avoid predictions. But,
if I can just
add, just a second question.
Can I just add to Friedman's question? Should we now understand Syriza as a status quo power or is not a systemic power? Is that what is it?
Very good questions. I, from what I see, without claim to make a prediction. In Greece, it was proved that there was huge reaction inside Caesar and among the Greek people against this capitulation, because this happened. On the other hand, it is I don't think that they have decided yet. The leadership of Syriza does not yet have a policy. It really believed what it was saying, that it could change the policy in Greece by staying in the euro. And now they really don't know what to do. They don't know even how.
They promised a lot of things.
And they believed. They believed that they could do it. I know because I, in my school, for example, there are many people who have taken very high positions in our government. We are a series of schools. But I mean the politics, political science school of the Aristotle University. So these people really believed these things, and now they are facing reality, which is they would have to keep their promises to the Greek people, or to go the way of Samaras, and they know that it would be a political suicide. If they go the way of Samaras. Because before the 2012 elections, Samaras also was saying, we will change what is coming, we will have a real negotiations with the European Union and all this. And after he got in power, he forgot everything. And now they have the example. They know that Syriza went from 4% to 30%, more than 30%, but in 1 year it might go back to 4%. The ones, but beyond that, there is a Syriza, is two parties in the cover of one. The left of Syriza, which is very well organized, but does not have the leadership, used to have around 40% in the, let's say, in the places that matter, in the Central Committee, and now it looks that it's having more than. In this last week, there were people who were pro-euro and now have changed inside the highest, let's say, conclave of cities. So we really don't know. Now they have a huge problem because they say to the people that we have finished with memoranda. Now they have to pass this agreement from the parliament. They had a parliamentary caucus in Syriza, and of the 149 deputies, 30 abstained, were not at the time of the vote, and from those who were there, 40 voted against. This means 70 out of 149. And this means that the government cannot bring easily the law for passage from the Greek parliament, which is today or tomorrow. I don't know what happened today. There is the other road for them would be to say that exactly because this is a continuation of the previous program, we just don't have to pass it from parliament. But this contradicts what they were saying last week, that it's not the continuation of the previous program, but the negation of the previous program. And all the time they were accusing the New Democracy that it passed all these very important things without parliamentary discussion of this. So they have a huge tactical problem at this moment in Syria. We don't know if next week there will be one Syria or two Syria, for example. Things are so serious.
Another question? Yeah.
Yes, I just want to say
that. Yeah, yeah, sure. I'm sure if Yahoo wanted to answer something before the.
Yes, it just sounds to me like sitting here listening to you, it seems to me like I have a situation of sharp political innocence here.
Both?
Of political innocence. Of naivete.
Political.
Innocence on the part of Syriza. It sounds like naivete. If you can give us this sharp analysis of what the Euro construct is all about, surely political leadership of Syriza should be aware of this as well.
Unfortunately, we should not be in a position of tactical difficulty right now. Unfortunately,
they believed in the Europe of the peoples. They went there and they said, we are in the spirit of the European Union. And of course, the others laughed.
since the topic is on the left in general, and well, I mean, now we're talking on Syriza as an example of left government. How do you explain the lack of or the reluctance of solidarity with Syriza, or the lack of position from other left parties, from left European parties in Europe beyond? I mean, beyond, I don't know, but just the paper declarations and just statements of solidarity. I mean, and in particular, my question is related with Die Linke from Germany, which beyond any positions they, well, yesterday they have said something, but it wasn't really decisive on that year.
Die Linke has no position on that. But they know that if they have to say something, they will lose influence in this agenda. So they don't support Syriza. And Syriza knows that if you notice, it always talks about Podemos. Podemos also is a pro-Euro party. And what happens in Greece now, of course, will influence the views of the left and the leftist of Europe. If it is proved now in Greece that we cannot have both the Euro and the egalitarian society, then Podemos will have to decide whether to ditch the Euro or to ditch its promises to the other people. But even if Podemos takes the government next year, this year in Spain, it's nothing. It could be just two countries against the rest. So you cannot change this construction, which is the European Union. You cannot. In Greece, before 2010, some of us were talking, do you see what is happening in Hungary? Do you see what is happening in Latvia? Nobody. Even in Syriza, even people who now have government position, nobody wanted to listen to anything. Because if you don't have it in your own country, you cannot concentrate your mind. This is the sad and very Marxist truth. So, the rest of the European Union will understand what is happening when the crisis arrives there. And it will arrive there. Because the plan is, after they impose the jungle in Greece, in Spain, in Portugal, then they will use it to tell to the French and to the German workers, you see, if you don't work for half the money, we'll just bring a Greek to take your place. It's also, it has been declared, not in these terms, but it's not a secret. That's the plan. It's not that Greece is just 2% of European economy. It's nothing. But it is the start. So we're in the way for either destroying the social state or creating a different Europe. But this different Europe will not be a continuation of this. It's not the way. I'm a very deep Europeanist and internationalist. I always was and I will always be. It does not mean being a Europeanist to say that we all must be slaves of the Frankfurt Paris. This is not Europeanism. This is what cultivates racism and the extreme right all over Europe. Do you think it is a coincidence that the extreme right thrives exactly in the years of the Euro, all over Europe, not only Greece? Simple. You have an extreme right financial policy, because this is what the Euro is, by constitution, and this has to have a political correspondence. And this is the rise of the extreme right.
Are there other questions?
Can I ask you about your views about Soviet communism? What historical question you
have? I have never supported Soviet communism.
What's the problem with it?
I come from the libertarian communist tradition, from the anti-Soviet left. However, I happen to have, after for the communism, in the last 10 years, I happen to have very close relationships with people in Moscow. And I went there and I saw, and I understood that, first of all, it was not as dark as we thought it to be. Now, I can say that it had many more positive features than what I used to think of. I could not see it. I would not support the recreation of something like that. It's historically impossible anyway. But compared to...
Because it was an attempt to destroy markets, the money, this sort of thing, the bank...
It had market. Immanuel Wallerstein, to whom I refer, has a grand theory, I think, that is very, very important. To come to terms with it, not to accept it. But actually, he describes, and I agree, the Soviet communism as a variety of liberalism. In 92, when he was president of the World Sociological Association, and when everybody was enthralled with the end of communism, well, this Wallerstein wrote an article at the time called The End of Liberalism. And he argued that what we are seeing now is not the end of the left, it's the end of the liberalism as a hegemonic ideology all over the world. And everybody then said, oh, the old man has lost his mind. 20 years later, I think that we read this, I give to my students every year, to my postgraduate students, and he knew what he was talking about. In his grand theory, we have after 1848, the institution of liberalism as the hegemonic ideology, and practically the transformation of conservatism into a right-wing version of liberalism and of socialism or radicalism, as he calls it, into a left-wing version of liberalism. But also taking the basic liberal conceptions and time frames and everything, just conservatives wanted to impose them a little more slowly, the leftists a little more quickly. But after the other world revolution of 1968, we have the destruction of liberalism as a hegemonic force and the recreation of a right that is a real right, conservative right, and the left that is a real left and the capitalist left. And this is what we're watching today all around the world, either consciously or unconsciously, because there are powers that are, they don't understand that they are on the left and they are on the left. And also powers that don't understand that they are on the right, and they are on the right. But what we will see in the coming decades will be a fight to the death between the left and the right. A left that will be very different from the Soviet paradigm.
This strikes me as a really very, like, Manichaean version of the world, as if there is a left and there is a right, and it's clear, like, especially this assumption that, like, even if you don't know, you still are, as if there were some kind of major plan according to which everyone is positioned on both sides of a division line. And it's very, I think it could be, it also reminds me of the example that you gave before, that there are two options that we would have to go and choose between, either a good democratic world or a bad version of capitalism nowadays. And I think that these kinds of figures can be a bit, they could somehow hinder the necessity of looking at differences which are maybe smaller, or other alternatives which don't necessarily
can be labeled as either left or right. And but also this is also like these kinds of rhetorics is often used by politicians on a very high level, which as me not saying someone which is schooled in political sciences. For example, when we see the rhetorics between let us choose between the US or Russia or the Western, either between the Western or the Islamic world, this is like it's very similar operation, saying there is this world which is divided between left and right. So I don't know what you think about whether there are not other options of seeking for alternatives.
I'm afraid that it's not only Wallerstein who says this, but even other, just to give a name that is much more acceptable nowadays, Thomas Piketty. He's not a left. He's in the French Socialist Party, which is definitely a conservative party, and he's for capitalism. But he shows that the concentration of wealth and income today is actually on world level and also on every European country level, is actually worse than at the time of the French Revolution. We have huge concentration of income, wealth and power on the one side. And these people also want to turn this into a political regime, which will be something like the ancien regime. This is obvious. It's not just dreamings. Actually, we have in 2013, we have the recognition in America that the legal equality in front of the law is over. There was the trial of the HSBC, the big bank that was again in headlines this week because of some misdemeanors. And at that time, the, let's say, the Justice Minister of America, the Attorney General, declared that the people who control that these financial corporations, the global, systemically important financial corporations are beyond the law. Because if you touch them, you may have very bad economic fallout. And they have made a list of 42 globally systemically important financial corporations which practically cannot be touched. And beyond that, we have the locally systemically important corporations, which also have a kind of higher state, higher legal status. It means that the people who control this, they not only they can do whatever they want, but actually they have the incentive to do in order to profit. So instead of having a double tier structure, which was the citizens and the Untermenschen, the refugees, the immigrants, the gypsies, the minorities who never had full rights. And this was the generally accepted situation in all capitalist countries up to now. Instead of having this, let's say, double-tier societies, we now have three-tier societies. There are those who are beyond the law, those who are the middle strata, who are in the confines of the law, and the lowest scum who are beneath the law, who have no rights. It is something very similar to the life before the bourgeois conceptions that came to be popularized after the French Revolution. As a historian, I see this as very, very plausible. This is where we are going. If you Google globally systemically important financial corporations, you will see all this discussion about this. It is not being discussed here. But also here, no, I don't know the details, Bulgarian details, but I'm sure that there are people here who are above me. In Greece, we have these people. And we say that you cannot have a democracy when you have these people. You must take it from them, take the basis of their social power. You cannot have a left policy with tycoons like Latsis, Bernagiannis, and Bogolas. You cannot.
Unfortunately, I have to put an end to this interesting discussion because we risk to be closed inside. thank you really for this.
Very, very interesting
participation. Thank you indeed.
So thank you. Следващия семинар ще се проведе на 17 март. Водеща бъде Райна Гаврилова и ще си говорим за бетониране на България под формата на новия традиционен културно наследство. Така че като тема сме фиксирали Дисниленд България и се надяваме, че Дисниленд няма да възникне.